हेलो एवरीवन, अ वेरी वॉर्म वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू. वेलकम टू स्वा एजुकेशन. माई सेल्फ राधा, एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट हाइजीन एंड सैनिटेशन इन टर्म ऑफ पेस्ट कंट्रोल एंड गार्बेज एंड सीवेज डिस्पोजल. सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टारगेट दिस पोर्शन. सो पेस्ट कंट्रोल प्रोसीजर इन फूड इंडस्ट्री. सो एज ऑल वी नो दैट रिस्क प्रपोज्ड बाय पेस्ट इन एनी फूड हैंडलिंग प्रीमिसेस आर डाइवर्स. देर इज अ स्प्रेड ऑफ डिसीज, डैमेज टू प्रॉपर्टी, इट इंक्लूड फूड स्टफ, एडवर्स पब्लिक ओपिनियन, डैमेज टू रेपुटेशन एंड द रिस्क, और वी कैन से एक्सपेंस ऑफ प्रोसिक्यूशन. Taken to its extreme, your food premises closer of the premises and perhaps with it the business. So, whether you are responsible for a restaurant takeaway, catering company, cafe, hotel or a burger van, you should be thinking about your pest control provision. Effective pest management program prevent not only the introduction of pest anywhere on the food site, but also reduce the condition that may encourage pest presence or facilitate their survival should they establish a presence. So pest control procedure in the food industry. So remember, this regulation and food hygiene regulation. So the regulatory framework, principally the Food Safety Act 1990 and the Food Hygiene Regulation 2005 made under it, seems for food unsafe if it is considered to be injurious to health or unfit for human consumption. So these regulation work whether the food is safe or unsafe, because unsafe food is injurious to the health or unfit for human consumption. It lay down general hygiene requirement for all food business operator. The layout design and construction of food premises should permit good hygiene practices, including protection against contamination, in particular adequate pest control. So these regulations work to control pest, because if they present into the food, that food is injurious to the health for human consumption. So the procedure should be based upon HACCP. What is HACCP? Hazard Analysis Critical Control Point. So this procedure based upon this principle. This identifies process which are most hazardous. Hazardous means unsafe for the consumption of any individual or human being. So measure can be taken to reduce risk. Second one is pest management is part of the GMP. What is GMP? Good manufacturing practice for food business, which is a prerequisite for the HACCP based procedure in place. As an integral part of GMP, it should be carried out with due diligence. So these two principles generally based upon hazardous substances and measure can be taken to reduce risk. So these two principles are used for the analysis purpose. Guideline drawn by the National Pest Advisory Panel, that is NPAP. So it is very important, what is NPAP? National Pest Advisory Panel of CIEH, Pest Control in the Food Industry Revised 2015, are aimed to the food manufacturing sector. Principles are the same for the production of, or we can say, raw material and ingredient supplier, warehousing, distribution and retail, but the level of pest control contract specification varies. So principles are same to control the hazardous substance or presence of those substance which are unfit for human consumption, but the level of control contract specification varies. So due diligence does not simply fall on a pest control contractor retained by the proprietor of food premises to deal with pest. It has to demonstrate good practice themselves and does not abrogate responsibility by using a contractor. Many proprietors assume that with a pest control contractor in place, they have done their bit on due diligence. So, guideline that is drawn up by National Pest Advisory Panel of CIEH Pest Control in the Food Industry revised 2015. What is the aim of it? Aim of it is food manufacturing sector, and the principle that working on that are the same for the production, but the level of pest control contract specification varies. So that guidance that drawn by the National Pest Advisory Panel, it commit the standard should be risk based guidance emphasis to address the issue raised by the risk to public health due to activities of pest and to the environment. Big business tend to be largely self-policing as they tend to have robust policies and procedure in place. Problem tend to be with the small operators, some restaurant that don't necessarily appreciate to the finger point of food hygiene. But the scope of some pest control contract is often inadequate to cover retail food outlet because the non-food room were not necessarily covered by the agreement. So reduced specification in the contract could mean areas remaining untreated. So the standards that is drawn or the guidelines that is drawn up by National Pest Advisory Panel and the pest control in the food industry based upon the risk. So the guideline emphasis to address the issue raised by the risk to public health due to the activities of pest and to the environment. So that is what. Next one is the pest control procedure in food premises. First one, stored product pest. When raw produce arrive at the food premises, it should be inspected for evidence of infestation from the outset. Stock must remain accessible for inspection at all time. One of the problem pest controller find is that the produce can get stored against a wall and there is no way around. Infestation from stored product pest can take hold without being easily detected. Second one is food or pest proofing. Food business should have pest prevention system in place, while including having the building proofed to a very high standard to prevent pest gaining access in first place. You might have door with a gap of maximum 5 mm to prevent rat or mice. Because if rat and mice present there, they will contaminate the food and that was unfit for human consumption. On critical area, you could install a fly screening up against the window and electronic fly killer inside. So that if anything does breach the screening, it can be arrested on the fly killer. It's good practice to analyze the catch to identify the various fly species. You might then be able to find whether they are coming from as a part of hazard analysis critical control point process or not. Next one is food waste disposal and handling practices to be considered. So food waste represents a large percentage of the waste stream for many industries, such as restaurant, hospital, nursing home, food manufacturing, processing facilities, supermarket, school, hostel, corporate offices, catering hall, food court, and many other locations. There is growing pressure for removing the organic waste from landfill. For establishment that serve food, there is an average of 1 pound of waste per meal served when both pre-sale and post-sale waste is considered. So now we are going to discuss a brief overview of some of the ways to address food waste. Of course, the solution for each industry and even each facility within the same industry will vary depending upon many factors. So waste reduction at the source. First one is to conduct a waste audit. What is it? Waste audit or waste analysis give you valuable information about your waste processing practice, as well as a roadmap for setting priorities and making prudent decisions that are based on efficiency versus guesswork. Waste audit can be as basic or as detailed as you have time for, but the point is to perform some type of waste audit that can be used as a basis for decision making. Second one is to reduce pre-sale food preparation waste. How we can do this? This is all the kitchen waste that is generated prior to sale to customer. It is estimated that up to 10% of the food purchased ends up becoming pre-sale food waste. To control waste during the food preparation stage, some suggestions are like be aware of the quantity and timing of food that is ordered, or what we can do, rethink production and handling practices. Have you staff try to observe and pinpoint where most of the waste is occurring in the preparation process? Or we can take a closer look at the menu to see if certain items or group of items account for most of the excess waste in the preparation stage. Or we can check out possibility for donating any excess preparation waste to local food shelters. Next one is to reduce post-sale food waste, means after selling of the food. How we can reduce that? This mainly involves waste from plates and order return. Some suggestion for controlling this waste can be like removing trays from the process so that patrons do not have a tendency to pile food up on the tray, or controlling the size of the portion given to patron and modification to the menu based on the close observation by the staff as to what is being discarded most often by patrons. Next one is, this is food recovery hierarchy. So most preferred source reduction means cooking using fresh ingredient in small batch, trayless dining and taking only what you are going to eat. Feed hungry people, feed animals, feed hungry people donating the food bank, feed animal using food scrap as animal feed, industrial uses recycling used cooking oil for biofuel, composting of food scrap and coffee grounds, and landfill oblique incineration, that is last resort to disposal. So this is from most preferred to least preferred. This is food recovery hierarchy. So food recovery for the needy, there are four basic categories of food recovery from the needy. One is perishable and prepared food. What is it? In perishable and prepared food, the collection of food waste during the food stages at facilities such as restaurant, food caterer, supermarkets, hospital, nursing home, school, etc., and distribution to needy through national groups such as food chain. Second one is non-perishable food donation. This involves the collection of processed food that have a long shelf life and distribution through networks such as Second Harvest. Next one is wholesale produce salvage. This involves the collection of fresh fruit and vegetable at local or regional wholesale and distribution through networks such as the Society of NGO. Next one is field gleaning. This involves the collection of crop from field that have either already been harvested mechanically or field where harvesting is not feasible and distribution through networks such as the society at NGO. There are many agencies that are anxious to distribute surplus food to the hungry. A few of the largest and well organized are indicated, like perishable and prepared food, non-perishable food donation, wholesale produce salvage, etc., and a few have been few others have been also presented there. However, there are literally hundreds in each local area. In addition to contributing toward hunger relief, there are also advantages when donating surplus food. So composting and food waste drying system. When considering on-site compositing, On food waste drying system, there are several questions that are important, such as space availability, space is available for composting or not, staff resources for separating food scrap from trash as well as operating the equipment, infrastructure availability, whether it is just electrical requirement or severe consideration, end use for the finished product, what finished product are usable or not, local support and cooperation of or obstacle from nearby business or residences, and approval from local enforcement agencies. So food waste drying system have these several questions that are very important. Of course, approval and permit requirement from local agencies will depend upon the type and volume of food being composted. The most common on-site method, first one is inertial composting, vermicomposting and anaerobic digestion. What is inertial composting? This type of system can generally process large amount of waste without taking up too much space. Means less space is required, but at the same time we can process large amount of waste in this inertial composting and can accommodate almost any type of organic waste like meat, biosolid, food scrap, etc. So this is inertial composting. So this process involves temperature, moisture, aeration control system where organic material are fed into equipment which has mechanism for turning or agitation the material for proper aeration. So it can also be used year round in almost all climate including extremely cold weather since the internal environment is controlled. Usually by electronic means. This process is fairly quick, means inertial composting is quick process and can take a little as a few weeks. However, for the microbial activity to stabilize into a finished compost, it can take several more weeks or month. Available land space as well as haulers and end user in your area will help you decide which is better for you. Some inertial system are fully automated with sensor to monitor temperature, oxygen, moisture. They use biofilter to reduce or eliminate odor or smell. This is a good method for institution with large amount of compostable material and limited space. So this inertial composting can be used. It is a good method in case of institution with large amount of material but limited space. So that is the benefit of this. Second one is vermicomposting. With this process, worms are used to break down the organic material. Means worm are used to break down large organic material into simpler one. Animal product or grease cannot be composted using this method. But this process can break down organic material into high value compost faster than inertial composting. Next one is anaerobic digestion. So this process, anaerobic means in absence of oxygen. So this process involves breaking down organic matter in an oxygen-free environment or oxygen-reduced environment or in the absence of oxygen in order to generate biogas, which is a combination of methane and carbon dioxide. The methane can then be burned for energy. The material that remain after digestion should then be composted aerobically to complete the process and produce a valuable soil amendment. Means what happens during anaerobic digestion in the absence of oxygen, you can produce biogas that is a combination of methane and carbon dioxide, methane burned for energy and the material that remain after digestion. We can compost that material aerobically to complete the process. In addition to energy production, another benefit of anaerobic digestion is that these systems require less space than many other large-scale composting methods, which means they are easier to locate in urban areas. So thank you so much everyone. If you find this video beneficial for you, please don't forget to like, share and subscribe this channel for more such kind of videos. And if you have any query regarding this lecture, you can comment down below.